Hi, I'm Leonard Kaplan.
And I'm Paul Fay.
And I'm Mel Simons, and I'm looking forward to appearing with both Len and Paul on...
Wrestling Talk! Welcome to Wrestling Talk. I'm Leonard Kaplan along with Zorba the Fay.
Zorba the Fay?
Zorba the Fay, that's what that
is. Now I gotta ask you, why are you calling
Because of that hat. You look just like Topol.
What's Topol?
In Zorba
Sounds
the
like
Greek.
Something you eat.
Don't you go to the movies? Topol is a famous Israeli actor that played Zorba the Greek.
No.
Wait a minute, he didn't play Zorba the Greek. Anthony Quinn did.
You know who we need to ask these questions to?
Mel Simons.
He would know.
The king of nostalgia.
And who and who do we have on the show tonight by coincidence?
Could it be Mel Simons?
Yes, it is.
The king of nostalgia.
Yes.
Boy, that's... We should get stuck like that more often.
Really?
You know? And guess who the other guest is?
I don't know. Tell me.
Well, I don't know either. You know why?
Why?
Because he has a mask. Not the pink assassin, but the hooded assassin.
The hooded assassin.
He's kind of a mean guy, but he cracks me up. I think people will see what I mean.
Mel Simons gave us a wealth of information to a lot of our, and I'm sure to a lot of our viewers' questions to where a lot of their old-time favorite wrestlers have gone. I mean, he just...
Right. And I think
he was great.
We should go to that right now and not waste any time talking about it ourselves.
Right.
We should talk about it
afterwards. I think our viewers will be very happy with what they see.
Okay, so let's go to that. Let's go to Mel Simons in his first interview with us.
Hi, I'm Leonard Kaplan.
I'm Paul Fay.
And we're from Wrestling Talk.
There's a problem that bothers us.
And that's drunk driving. Thousands of people are killed and injured every year because of drunk driving.
So take our advice.
Don't drink and drive, because as they say in the wrestling world, this may be the last body slam you'll ever take.
Welcome back to Wrestling Talk, or maybe I should say Wrestling Talk Trivia, because our special guest is Mel Simons, the nostalgia trivia expert, as well as wrestling announcer. Glad you could make it, despite all the delays that we've put you through.
Thank you, Len. Paul, nice to be with you guys. Been looking forward.
And Paul Fay, I have to congratulate you. I like your hat this week. I usually don't like it.
There must be something you'll be able to find wrong with me, though.
I can't see a thing. In fact, you're dressed better than I am today. I left you speechless for once.
It does happen every once in a while.
Anyway, we have Mel Simons here in the studio, and Mel, you're into everything. And the reason we asked you on Wrestling Talk is because you're in the wrestling world as a wrestling announcer. What is it like being a wrestling announcer, and how did you get into that despite all your other myriad of activities?
Well, it's very interesting being a wrestling announcer, and quite unlike any other form of wrestling, being a wrestler or a timekeeper or a referee. It's a very unique thing being an announcer. As far as how I got started announcing with Killer Kowalski, about 6 years ago, and I announced quite a bit for WWF, and to this day I still do WWF, AWA, World Class, when they are in the Boston area, and of course Kowalski's group, the International Wrestling Federation. I get to meet some great wrestlers, many of whom I like. Many of whom I don't like, many of whom are very cruel to me in the ring.
There's one in particular I don't like.
Who's that, Paul?
And that's Dr. D.
Here we go again, folks.
I don't know if you heard about that incident or not.
Are you going to talk about that again?
No, not very long.
Well, you know, it's funny.
I figured while we were on the subject about wrestlers that we don't like, I mention it.
Well, you know, I kind of thought you fellas would ask me who are some of the guys that give me a rough time.
Yeah,
who are they?
And Dr. D immediately, as you say, Paul, comes to mind. Now, I have...
See, there you go.
I have never done anything to Dr. D that I know of. I am very impartial as an announcer, and basically as an announcer I stand in the center of the ring and I announce where they're from, I announce their weight and their name. If there's any discrimination on the name, I will ask a wrestler how he pronounces his name. Well, Dr. D is just not pleased with me, and it seems that whatever I do with him, I do wrong. Mm-hmm. For example, if I will announce his weight as 255 pounds, he will whack me. Maybe I'll be off a pound. I was given, say, 255. Maybe he's 254. Maybe he's 256. But he will make such a scene in the middle of the ring and will always embarrass me, doesn't care at all, and he'll just whack me around.
Doctor, see, I'm sick of talking about Dr. D. I'm really more angry at Dr. D myself than Paul is, because since Paul has had this little brush with Dr. D, he's been a different person.
No, I got hit by a camera. He ripped my camera away from me, and then he hit me with it.
See, but since this happened, Paul is a little paranoid when it comes to wrestlers. He had a little incident with Man Mountain Mike, which occurred
on
this show, which occurred because he was paranoid about the Dr. D incident. Forget about Dr. D. All wrestlers are not like Dr. D.
Yeah, it's the truth.
You know?
Well, not all wrestlers are like Dr. D. He's a tough guy. I mean, I seem to always rub him the wrong way. He doesn't like me. I don't know why. I never did anything to him personally. But I am genuinely, when I introduce him, I'm just prepared to run out of the ring after I announce his name. I don't know what state of mind he will be in or what he will do to me personally.
Well, let's face it. I mean, Man Mountain Mike's a big boy. I mean, you've
he sure is.
So why did you do that to Man Mountain Mike?
Yeah, but I mean, because, hey, you know.
I'm still,
what did you do? I don't know what you guys are talking about. What did
we
you
had
do?
Man Mountain Mike on the show.
Yeah.
And Paul was making reference to, well, I don't think Man Mike can move in the ring. And he was saying
that,
this.
You said it to his face?
He said it to his face.
Well, I was sort of on, I was on the side
I
of
I covered
him.
Up for him as much as I could.
Yeah.
And so finally, Man Mountain Mike, as anybody would, got a little perturbed,
sure.
Took his mic off and knocked Paul over. You know,
I guess,
and I wouldn't go that far, but knocked Paul over.
No,
and,
I would knock Paul over, and I also would not make fun of Man Mountain Mike's.
I think what it was,
because you probably hit a nerve when you did it, and
yeah.
You resented it. Obviously.
Well, I think what it might have been was when I'm so frustrated from, I mean, what Dr. D did
sure.
to me. He ruined a good camera. I probably was taking out my frustrations
exactly.
on Man Mountain Mike,
exactly.
And I guess the best
wrong
way.
Person.
I guess the best way. For me to do that was because of, you know, to use his size.
Yeah. And he obviously resented you.
Well,
his size.
Why don't
yeah.
you buy a Dr. D balloon or something and punch that around?
Well,
I would. Get a punching bag with his picture on it and just whack it around.
Our watches on future shows, we'll see what happened with the Man Mountain Mike incident.
But,
I'd like to see that myself.
But that's not the end of that story. I didn't have Dr. D. I'm thinking Dr. D. I had Man Mountain Mike on separately without Paul being present. And somehow he found out about it. In the last 3 minutes of the show, Paul came into the studio, interrupted that interview, and we had yet another incident
on
wrestling.
Oh, this was the second interview.
Yes,
with
we did two. I did the second because I didn't get a chance to ask him certain things because I was rudely interrupted.
You know what, Len? This guy is a glutton for punishment.
I guess so.
Boy, oh boy.
Maybe I am.
You know, I just like to speak my piece, you know what I mean?
Well, it's very nice to speak your piece, but sometimes you're treading on very thin water with some of these wrestlers and their temperaments.
Sometimes,
you have to be careful, especially the bad guys.
If you don't speak your piece, you may get some real peace, you see.
I go along with that. Yeah, absolutely. But some of these guys in the ring, they are there.
Or if you speak your piece, somebody will get a piece. No.
So let's give peace a chance.
Oh, never mind. Never mind. A little silent.
Let's move on to another subject.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay, so people like Dr. D bother you, obviously. What about the Pink Assassin? We had him on.
Pink Assassin does not like me. Now, the Pink Assassin has been very, very nasty.
He's never given you a rose.
He's never given
me a rose.
He gave me
a rose and something else, too.
He's given me other things, but not a rose. Again, he resents me. I don't know if it's the way I pronounce his name or, again, his weight. I could be a quarter pound off. I mean, what's the big deal if you say a guy weighs 222 and a half rather than 222 and a quarter?
Well,
this guy, let me tell you, fellas, will make such a big deal of the fact that I got a quarter of a pound wrong, and it's the way it was given to me. He gets so angry and he yells and he screams and he'll go out of the ring and he'll refuse to wrestle until I get his name and weight.
Well, correct. Now some of the matches I've been at, isn't it true that he gets very upset when they start yelling things at him?
Yes.
Things that
you were going to say one, I know.
Yeah, I can't say that on the air.
Yeah, no, you can't say it on the air, but a certain word that people use in reference to, well, certain people that are gay. And he makes no bones about what he is, and he just does his thing. And sometimes the fans will get a little too boisterous, as fans will. Well, he goes crazy. He will cover his ears and even
he's even asked you to ask them to stop chanting.
Exactly. And you know what happens? When I ask the fans to stop chanting the words that they yell out at him, the fans will yell it out even louder.
Oh,
and he goes crazy. He'll go back to the dressing room. Sometimes
I've seen that happen many a times.
It's,
sure.
It's like when you're a kid. If you're a kid and somebody's picking on you, if you tell them to stop, the louder you tell them, the more they'll pick on
you. Exactly. And it's the same thing in wrestling. He is a very strange gentleman. Gentleman, well, kind of loosely, I'm using that word. A great wrestler. The Pink Assassin is a marvelous wrestler, I've announced him.
So he says, I've yet to see him.
Oh, he's a foreign wrestler.
Oh, he is.
Would you agree with me, Paul?
Yeah, he can take care of himself.
Wonderful.
In the ring. Some of the holes he puts on his opponents are a little weird, but...
Well, that's because he's a weird gentleman. I hope he does not resent me saying that. I mean, he's a great wrestler.
Well, I mean,
he's an unusual wrestler.
He's pretty much made it known, you know, his lifestyle, whatever.
Yes, yes.
So,
and I admire him for speaking his piece, but he goes a little overboard with the way fans react to him.
For the benefit of the audience, that word that Mel was mentioning that people say to the Pink Assassin, it begins with an F, and the definition in Old English, one definition is a bag of sticks.
Well said.
just had
so,
to say that.
So, if you look up in your dictionary,
well, I think most of the
beyond that, I won't.
Know what you're talking about. But he's something else. I mean, I never call him, I never use that word. I'm completely impartial. It is the fans that drive him crazy.
Mm.
Plus the fact he doesn't like me for whatever reason, I don't know.
Okay, now he's one of the guys that's pretty much in the local scene. Let's talk about people like Larry Zbysko and some of the more well-known, wider-known wrestlers.
Isn't it funny, Len? I started to say I've had the pleasure of announcing Larry Zbysko, but it really hasn't been a pleasure. Larry Zbysko, where other people may resent what I say about them, where they're from, or their weight, or perhaps mispronounce their name, Larry Zbysko doesn't like anything that is said about him. And many times he'll be right on top of me as I'm announcing where he's from, and he will start yelling at me, he will start cursing me in the ring, and then he will grab the mic to correct me before I've even said anything.
He's a little disturbed, I
would
say. He
is a lot disturbed. Larry Zbysko is a great wrestler, but not with full deck.
I think I'd be afraid to have him on Wrestling Talk, even if he was... What about you, Paul?
Well, you guys take your life in your hands if you have Larry Zbysko.
Nobody's attacked me so far, but I think that may be the first time when he was on.
If we value the equipment we have in this studio,
yeah,
we may have second thoughts about having you.
Yeah.
Tear the place apart.
Yeah.
Another guy that comes to mind that's given me a rough time, and I've announced him many, many times, is Abdullah the Butcher.
Oh, I've heard. Isn't he...
He is one weird dude.
Is that is that the AWA?
He is AWA, and most recent, he is world class.
Right.
Out of Texas. And he does a lot of independent wrestling. Great wrestler, about 450 pounds, give or take a few.
While we're on the subject of big wrestlers again... Is it true that Haystack Calhoun passed away recently?
No.
It is?
No,
I heard.
Not.
Really?
Haystack, I don't know how this rumor got started, and everybody says he's passed away. He is retired, and he had gangrene in his foot.
Right.
Had a couple
he
of
lost
toes.
His leg, didn't he?
I don't know if it was a leg or a few toes.
Gee, we're going to have to find out the real scoop about this.
I think he's still with us. I have not heard anything about him passing away.
I heard a few weeks ago a rumor.
Well, didn't Man Mountain Mike tell us that?
Yeah, Man Mountain Mike told us that he passed away.
It was announced on the TV show where he wrestles. I heard the announcer say it. But honestly, guys, I don't think he has passed away at all.
Well, Mel, I'm sorry.
I can see why.
Sorry to cut you off too, Paul and Mel. We're out of time for this segment. I hope you come back sometime.
Been a pleasure, guys. Thank you.
And,
great having you.
We'll be right back with another segment right after this.
Come back, and that was our segment with Mel Simons, and I hope all our viewers and watchers and listeners.
Isn't a viewer and a watcher the same thing?
You always start on me, don't you? Always. Anyways.
And people could be watching with the sound down, then they'd just be watching.
Right.
But hopefully that's the first of our many opportunities to talk with Mel, because there's a lot of things I wanted to ask him.
I mean, I can't believe some of the questions that we asked him. He just rattled off the answers like...
He had his opinions about Dr. D.
Yeah, he sort of sided with me.
He said, I side with you also. Why do you take the position?
No, I know that.
I am against you. I am your co-host, your co-producer, your cohort. Why would I side against you?
Let's not get that person.
Well, okay. Who are you anyway? I'm not mine. Our second segment has somebody that we all know, but we don't know, the Hooded Assassin.
I wonder if he's any relation to the Pink Assassin.
Well, we asked him that, if you recall, and I don't think he took too kindly to that.
Right. We can't actually say... Well, we could actually say what he said, because he said it already, so...
What did he say?
About the Pink Assassin.
What did he say?
He said about him being a sissy and...
That's as far as you go.
Okay.
I
could always give the definition that you talked about with a bag of sticks.
That was with Mel.
Right. When we talked about the Pink Assassin.
My question about the Hooded Assassin is, who came first, the Hooded Assassin or the Pink Assassin, as far as
the original chicken or the egg?
Or the chicken or the egg, right?
The horse before the cart.
Don't call the Hooded Assassin a chicken or an egg, or else you might be fried. Before I do any more bad puns, let's go to the Hooded Assassin right now after this.
Most physicians don't make house calls anymore, but there is one medical professional who still does, the veterinarian. Farms, zoos, racetracks, wherever animal care is needed, the veterinarian is there. Come celebrate a century of caring with the Massachusetts Veterinary Medical Association. An educational exhibit about veterinary medicine is now on display.
Welcome back to Wrestling Talk. We have with us now the Hooded Assassin, who is no relation to the Pink Assassin, by the way.
Do we know that for sure, though?
You know it for sure. Get me in the ring. I don't come out with no flowers. I come out there, I do a business, I kick somebody's butt. I don't go around prancing around the ring. I destroy a man right away.
Okay, you don't fool around.
No.
I think you just made that point.
Yeah,
I think so. The job and I get it done.
Are you trying to get rid of me? I mean, rid of me. Are you trying to get even with me for all the past shows that I've been correcting you?
That's correct.
Okay. okay. No. Just a little inside wrestling talk humor. Mm-hmm. I guess you don't appreciate that, Hooded.
Humor's okay outside the ring. In the ring, I mean business. I mean to destroy. I mean to crush. I mean to antagonize to the limit.
Can I call you Hooded? I'm not trying to make fun of you. I'm sorry. I don't want to get into trouble like Paul did with Man Mountain Mike. Anyway, how did you get started in wrestling, and did you always wrestle with a mask?
I've always wrestled with a mask. I don't want my private life intruded on by my public life. Mm-hmm. I've always had a mean streak. I've had that inner ability to piss people off in plain English. And I'm sorry, but nobody's ever liked me, and I really don't care because it's not a popularity contest. I'm in there to make money and destroy, and I do both jobs very well.
Have you ever held a major title before?
I don't bother with titles. Titles are meaningless. I want money. I want competition, and I want it proven I'm number one. A belt doesn't mean anything.
What's under your hood, though?
That's none of your business.
Paul. Paul's been very bold lately.
I think he's got a nice streak.
These wrestlers coming on and throwing their weight around like this guy's doing.
First of all, I think you weigh a little bit more than he does. No offense, okay? Second of all,
maybe I should go to the same gym that Man Mountain Mike goes to then, shouldn't I? And work it off.
I may just storm off the set, you know?
He's got a nice mean streak. I like that. Properly channeled, I can make him a destroyer.
No.
I can make him anything I want.
Please don't. Please don't.
He's got a nice inner streak.
Paul's a nice guy. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here. Okay? We're partners, right, Paul?
That's
still
correct.
Still partners?
Correct.
Okay. Paul's just having a little problem adjusting to what happened to him with Dr. D.
He smashed that reporter just the way I would have. Only I don't think he went far enough.
Mr. Stossel.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, outside the ring, you say that humor is acceptable, correct?
Right.
I said correct this time. Now, Mr. Stossel, why would you beat up, not you, but why would Dr. D beat up such a man?
He asked a stupid question, one that everybody in the business is tired of. Is it fake? I don't stand there and look like a fool for nobody.
Well, is it?
You think I want to look like the pink assassin for any amount of the money in the world?
You just said you're in there only for the money.
Yeah, but I don't want to look like a fool. That's why I get the job done my way.
You know, I'd like to borrow that mask and put it on him backwards so that he can't say anything.
Does that mean what I think it does?
It could. What of it?
No, I just...
Little Three Stooges humor.
Well, there's nothing wrong with an open mind like he has. The only danger is you have, instead of something coming in, you have a danger of losing everything and it going out. Just remember that.
Okay, okay. Now, what federations have you wrestled in?
I work for the AWA, the NWA, and the ICW.
Have you ever held any major titles?
I told you, I'm not interested in titles.
You're not.
I wrestle as much as any champion, work hard as any champion, and I'm probably having a better time at it than they are.
Do you eat the breakfast of champions?
No.
Have you tried Wheaties?
I've tried Wheaties. Wheaties won't get you nothing. You're going to get out there and eat something that's high protein. And no cereal is going to give you that. You've got to take your vitamins and watch yourself very carefully.
That sounds almost like Hulk Hogan advice.
It's good advice. That's why he's the champion, I guess.
Okay, now you mentioned that you wrestle for the money and you make... Do you think you make more money than champions?
No, but I make as much money as anybody like me possibly can. I've channeled my energies, and I know my strengths and weaknesses, and I capitalize on it, and my opponent's strengths and weaknesses.
Mm.
And that's the main thing. That's how you make money. You don't make money by being an idiot and not knowing your homework on your opponents, which unfortunately some of these idiots do.
Okay, that's interesting. Now, how do you go about, how far in advance before a match do you know who your opponent is, and how do you go about researching him?
Well, you only know about sometimes as much as only a few days before time who you're going to fight. And if you've got a knowledge of who's who in the business, you know their moves. If not, you talk to somebody like Bobby Heenan. You talk to somebody that knows their man. You talk to somebody that's wrestled them.
Mm-hmm.
And then you find out what they've done. If you don't know what they use for a finishing move, you try and find out. Because once they try and put a finishing move on you, if you're thinking of the counter already, when they go to slap it on, they've got a big surprise coming because you've got the counter already.
Okay, now do you use any foreign objects in your matches?
I don't use nothing but me. I'm enough for anybody. I proved that with Robbie Ellis, Eric Sprecher, and all the other lightweights they've got. I want some of the big guys, where the big money is. I don't want these little namby-pambies.
Okay, Paul, you have any?
Well, now, I've heard contrary to that about the foreign objects. I heard you have used foreign objects before in the ring.
That's a bunch of bull. It's never been proven.
I've heard it also.
You're going to hear what you like, because I'm going to tell you something. No explanation is necessary if you believe. And if you disbelieve, I can't say anything that enough to satisfy either of you two.
Okay, okay. Well, we don't want to get you angry or anything so that you'll storm off or anything like that. Paul isn't going to say anything. How are you, Paul? That'll lead in that direction. No, you're not. Now, I almost called you... I'm sorry, I almost called you Pink Assassin.
Could get him in.
No. I just a slip of the tongue. I'm not used to looking at somebody with a mask. You know?
Except the Pink Assassin.
You're the second person with a mask that we've had on Wrestling Talk. That's what I should say.
Well, so I'd like to meet him sometime and end that controversy over who's an assassin and who isn't. He could kill a man, but I think it might take him a few nights.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever been seriously hurt or injured yourself in the ring?
I've had every bone in my body broke. But like any good wrestler, you bounce back. You don't waste time. You work the injury as much as you can, heat up the muscle so you can get it back the way it should be. You let it rest, it's going to stay cold. You don't need that.
So you just get right back on the horse.
Get right back on it. Exercise as much as possible right away. Billy Graham was a smart man. He knew what to do. Don't sit there. Work it. Mm-hmm. Work it hard. Work it till you can't stand it no more, and then work it some more.
A superstar Billy Graham, would he be somebody that you would admire or not?
Oh, I've always admired him. He's a man that knew what he was doing. He came from a family of wrestlers. Look at the talent in his family. Crazy Luke Graham, mm-hmm. Eddie Graham, mm-hmm. Dr. Jerry, mm-hmm. and Mike. That's talent. That's a family. Yeah, I'll give you a Graham cracker, all right. I'll bet you put away a few of them.
But I go to a health club and work out.
Your elbow with those Graham crackers?
He tries to get me to go to the health club, too, but I don't want to look like that.
Thank you, Lenny.
I'm sorry, Paul. You walk into these things.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, it kind of does. Open mouth and insert both feet. It's a good thing you keep.
Anyway, to make up for it, Paul, I'll let you ask the next question.
What part of the country do you come from? What did I say?
Good question. I like that one. What?
Are you one of those wrestlers that I hate these wrestlers that come on and parts unknown.
I'm not one of those. Parts unknown.
Okay, good.
No, I'm not. In point of fact, I'm from Buzzards Bay, Massachusetts, if you want to know the truth.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Is there really buzzards there?
Yeah, we got quite a few. I think I saw one of your dates down there last week.
You know, buzzards, not buzzards, Bay, but Pat's unknown.
Oh, you mean Betty?
Yeah, I think that was her name, Betty the Buzzard. She was circling, looking for some new territory and something to scout, some kind of talent.
Okay, let's...
She must not have found you then.
I wasn't there. I'm on the road, unlike some people.
I want to thank you very much for coming on the program. I hope that you'll come back despite our little levity, shall we say, between Paul and I. If one of us said anything to offend you, we apologize.
That's okay. It's been an honor and a pleasure. Your honor and your pleasure.
Okay. Okay, I guess it has. Paul?
Where do you get your hoods?
I wanted to ask that. Where do you get your hoods?
I got a little old lady somewhere in Sheboygan, Illinois, making them up for me. Now, what do you need to know that?
Well, in case we ever wrestle under a mask, I don't know.
Well, come on, and talk.
It is almost Halloween, you know.
Yeah, you don't need one. You don't need a mask.
See, he's starting again.
Okay, no. And we're going to finish. So we'll see you in the wrap-up after this break.
Hi, I'm Leonard Kaplan.
I'm Paul Fay.
And we're from Wrestling Talk.
There's a problem that bothers us.
And that's drunk driving. Thousands of people are killed and injured every year because of drunk driving.
So take our advice.
And don't drink and drive, because as they say in the wrestling world, this may be the last body slam you'll ever take.
Welcome back to Wrestling Talk. What did you think about the Hooded Assassin, Paul?
Well, like I think you said in the opening, that he's kind of an arrogant guy.
There's something about him that just cracks me up. I don't know what it is. I wouldn't say that to his face. In fact, I shouldn't say it here. He might be watching, but...
Well, I mean, you saw what happened when I tried to look under his mask. Yep. He wasn't too happy.
I have to admit, normally I would say to you, why did you try to do that? But I was going to do the same thing.
Yeah.
But because he's so... I don't know. You can't take the guy seriously for some reason.
Well, the thing that got me, I mean... He's money hungry, mm-hmm. so he told us, but at the same time he says he doesn't care about whether he has the opportunity to have a shot at the championship belt for whatever federation it might be.
Right.
You know, I mean, that doesn't. All he says, all he's really interested in is the money or whatever.
Well, I mean, at least he's honest about that. I guess you have to say that. You know.
If he was making that much money, I suppose he could go and buy one of the ones you can buy from the wrestling magazines right near the. The back there where they saw the little
true.
Jokes.
Not much meaning in that.
You know, the hot gum and the x-ray glasses.
Yeah. I never bought the x-ray glasses, did
no,
you?
No, I never have.
You sure? Okay. Anyway.
I'll tell you after the show.
Oh, okay. I think that's all the time we have for this week. And next time, I'm going to try to get a hold of Man Mountain Mike and do an interview myself, like I said. Maybe kind of put in a good word for you, Paul. And maybe he'll be back on with both of us someday after that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure who we have for the second half. But until then, this is Leonard Kaplan along for Paul Fay, inviting you to stay in the ring.
Drift up to the night.